Thank you. Thank you. And in the business department, we think proofreading and editing is so important. We actually created a 2-credit class on practicing it and putting it all together and using your reference manuals. So we're having fun with the printers this morning, checking things out. So I'm going to wing this. The good thing is I should know what I'm talking about. So let's see how this goes. Did everyone get a flyer and see that you are here to talk about proofreading and editing? And did you read the title? How many of you read the title and went, what? What's this person doing? This one can't write. Why are they in this conference? Yes. So in the description, I actually had them put the phrase errors intended so that the integrity of the quality of the conference would not be compromised for exactly that reason. So as Nora said, I have been teaching in the business department as an adjunct for about 12 years and temporary full-time for about 2 years. I started out in office administration. And once I fell into teaching and went, wow, this is what I should be doing, realized I should have more degrees than my students do. So I went back to school and finished off a bachelor's and then went on to get my MBA. I'm also a certified administrative professional through the International Association of Administrative Professionals. So I got a few degrees and designations in there to help us out. But you know what? That doesn't mean I put together quality work. I need this class just as much as everybody. So we don't have a board to write on, so just holler out to me. Tell me one thing, a word or a phrase that you do right now for proofreading. What are you proofreading? What's your process? Holler out a phrase. Start up here. Metacognition. Metacognition, okay. Just holler it out. What do we have? Do you proofread anything? What?
Essays.
What else? What do you guys proofread?
Status.
What is that?
Statuses.
Statuses? Yeah. On Facebook?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Emails.
Emails. Oh, we'll talk about those.
Resumes,
absolutely.
Song lyrics.
What's that?
Song lyrics.
Those are some fun ones. I still want to know, I saw somebody once put together in a single song, included a word or a phrase from at least every one of Dolly Parton's songs. And I still, like, how many hours does it take to do that? What a creative mind. Yes, fun too. What's your process when you proofread? We haven't heard from this group in the back yet. How do you proofread?
When you see a red squiggle.
When you see a red squiggle on your computer screen, pay attention to it, absolutely. What's another thing you do?
Read it out loud.
Read it out loud? Excellent. What's another thing?
Read it backwards.
Backwards. Gosh, why am I giving this presentation? You guys have got it. All right, let's see if it all puts it all come to down together. Do you ever have someone else read your work?
No.
No, we're good. When? When would you have someone else read your work?
In like the first or second draft.
But what type of document? First, she said first or second draft, but what type of document?
An essay.
Something that you want a good grade on, you're thinking of? We talked about resumes. Would you have somebody else read those? Absolutely. Anything else you would have someone else read? Ooh, let's see if we can come up with some stuff. All right. Supposedly this little mouse is going to help us move forward. Let's see if it works. Our goal today is to explore errors in writing, to explore ways to ensure your writing is error-free and effective. And along the way, we want to make sure that maybe we at least laugh, groan. We're not going to cry. We might have a chuckle. If necessary, I'll prompt. Okay? I won't have cards like they do on TV shows, but I'll let you know. There you go. Are proofreading and editing important? Well, as I said here in the business department, we believe they're important enough that we actually created a class about proofreading and editing and using a resource manual to understand it. Can you ever get a first impression back? Can you ever recover from a first impression? You say yes? One person says yes. What kind of scenario are you thinking of when you say yes? What does it take to recover a first impression?
It takes repetitive encounters.
Repetitive encounters. Now, my husband and I have a thing where if one of us comes home, we believe that greeting is the most important way to set the tone for how you're going to interact in the house. And if one of us comes home and it doesn't go well, we will ask for a redo. Go back out the door, let's start this over and greet as well. But first impressions are really hard to overcome, and you're exactly right. Repetitive encounters would be the way to make it happen. Repetitive quality encounters. But think about it. You send out a letter to a client. That's the only way you communicate with this client. Are you really going to have a lot of repetitive quality encounters to get that back? Might not stay a client. Your coworkers, you probably send a lot of emails. You could have opportunity to improve your reputation with them because you could have a lot of quality encounters. And in fact, if you have enough quality encounters, when you do send one out with a typo, you can share a good chuckle over it. Same with clients, though. If that's the only way they communicate with you and your emails are full of errors or slang or texting, they're going to get a different impression of you than you want to send out. Resumes. How many of you have gotten a job that you're aware of and you had a typo in your resume? Ooh, one out of the whole room. Major typo, minor typo?
Misspelling of a name.
Okay. I'd be interested to talk later on what type of position was that they thought it was okay to misspell an actual name and still got it. That's a very accommodating, flexible company. Names are really important to get right. In fact, in my research on this, I was pulling some stuff off the web and just saw where somebody cited a case where the magistrate, the judge, actually reduced an attorney's fees because of errors in their submitted documents and the fact they spelled the judge's name wrong. Not a good idea. Teachers. Anybody in an online class? Okay. A few of you. How do you communicate with your teachers in an online class?
Emails.
Do you know we actually chuckle and use you as examples sometimes? Anonymously. We wouldn't do that to anybody. But it could be something like, oh my gosh, did you see the email I sent? I know instructors that actually send them back going, when you have corrected this, please resubmit it. I'm not that ready for that. I like the idea, but I'm like, oh, students have issues. There's emergencies come up. We need to handle this. There really isn't the time for that in my classes, I feel. But other people are very firm about it. When you submit this incorrect grammar and complete sentences, I'll be happy to respond to it. Wow. Sounds a little harsh, but they're actually helping you. YouTube. I did a search on YouTube. Importance of proofreading. Over 19,000 videos popped up in the list. I only skimmed the first screen. But wow, that's enough that people are getting prolific out there with the videos. So here's one. Let's check out why proofreading is actually important. And I've got some notes on here on the 10 worst in history. Let's see if this will work. Should pop up. I'm going to actually turn the volume off. Come back. Love it. The challenges of using a mouse. What are you doing? Go. Thank you. I'm going to change the volume off because I want to be able to actually pause this as these are coming up. Newspaper articles from the industry of education. Can you see this? Mississippi's literacy. We need a read-in specialist. I might be in the way. Okay. Students cook and serve grandparents. How'd they taste? You like it? We hate math, 4 out of 10. What's a majority? Over half is a majority. Okay. Principal kills the fifth grade band. I hope he got life. All right. You can get your high school diploma at home. The rest of us are going to get a diploma, but you can get a diploma. Mm-hmm. Summit County's teachers are highly qualified. Teach English. Now, the good news is, it's not educators writing these, I don't think. But still, what does it do for our industry, our education? You can be a hooker on phonics. The rest of us will get hooked on phonics. Yeah. Older kids who stay up later often are sleepier. Sleepler is what that actually says. It took me about 3 times reading this to catch that one. Yeah. Yeah, you can tutor. This one's interesting. How does a one-armed man applaud? Oak Creek High School needs a part handbook, a dent part handbook. Okay? And the university cracks down on plagiarism. Look at, you can have a reduction of grades all the way up to explosion. And the spelling bee is tomorrow. All right? Now this is cute. You're head of a deaf school and you give a verbal resignation? Seriously. Didn't want to resign or what? And we have a scholarship day coming up. Actual newspaper articles these are taken out of. Okay. Yeah, now we've got a Coke deal. Are we talking drugs or are we talking soda pop? Right? An alternative billing. We're going to have an education group. We're going to change over. And the daughter quit school. We must sell her. So don't quit school. Your parents might sell you. Okay? Yeah. So definitely we can already see that we can have chuckles and groans about them and usually recover somewhat from them. Let's see what we've got here under 10 worst in history. This is an interesting list. And some of these we will just spot check on because they're going to have a little bit of duplicates and things in them. Maybe. Top 10 all time and the top 10 funniest. Oh, PowerPoint doesn't want to work this morning. What have you got in your life? What have you already encountered that you know? Thank you, ma'am. What have you come across? Do you find anything in your textbooks? That dirty word, do you actually read them?
No.
A few of you do, I know you do. A few do. Have you found any?
One of my tests that was written by the school, it was like mostly typos.
The test written by an instructor was full of typos. Very helpful reading. Did you ace it?
I did.
Yes? I have a class where you can get extra credit for bringing those kind of things to attention. Shoot, it's this class, now that you mention it. What else? Where else do you find typos in your life right now?
Work.
What kind of things happen at work?
My boss spells a lot of things wrong, so I feel like I have to go back and correct her.
Her boss spells a lot of things wrong, so she has to go back and correct the boss. Absolutely. And in my world of office administration, that's what I'm there for. That's one of my crucial skills to be able to bring to that workplace is to support my boss in their weaknesses. When you are out and hiring people, make sure you hire people that match have strengths that are your weaknesses, so you become a balanced team. All right, top 10 proofreading mistakes. You'll be surprised at what they can cost you. There was a King James Bible released back in 1632. That it had a typo in the Ten Commandments. I don't know if you're familiar with those or not, but one of them says, thou shalt not commit adultery. In the 1632 edition, it said, thou shalt commit adultery. Yes! King James was not happy, and I think about, a few of the subjects were. I think about seven of them have made it. He wanted it. Women's World Magazine was looking for a professional proofreader, and they even called their own magazine wrong. Instead of woman, it was women on it. Tattoo artist, anybody seen any tattoos that didn't turn out? Yeah. How easy is it to change those? Don't think so. University in Wisconsin in 1988, if you graduated from there, your diploma spells Wisconsin wrong. They are all over the world. They are not just in school. They do happen. We are human, but our goal is to figure out ways to minimize them and reduce them, and if we can, potentially eliminate them. Where was it? To be, what's the phrase? To be or? Well, not according to the three professional proofreaders that read it in an English, it doesn't tell us where it was published, but there was a version of it published that went through three proofreaders and nobody caught that phrase was wrong. One of the things. All right. What else do we have here? Page up. In the cemetery, instead of cemetery?
And there it was in wrought iron forever.
Okay. I just read one, even just this morning, because, you know, I'm just really geeked about this, and I've been up all night, not quite, but still reading more things. There's one up here, if we get to it, it'll tell us that the Lincoln Memorial, everybody know the Lincoln Memorial? Mm-hmm. Has a plaque on there, Lincoln's speech, and one of the words was spelled wrong. Future starts with an E instead of an F. Mm-hmm. Now, that one, how much does an error cost you? Yeah, you want to re-chisel a granite stone? They said no, so they decided to fill it in. So if you go to the Lincoln Memorial, go look for that because you can still see it just barely. Did you know Google was a typo? And look how it's working for them. You can recover from some. Chili. In 2010, a man was sacked after he authorized production of 1.5 million coins that spelled chili wrong. Yeah. Controversial seasoning. This one salts with salt and freshly ground black people. Again, how did it taste? Not as good as you'd think. There's number six is a picture of the Bible. What among Barack Obama, this is June 2010, Australia's Parliament House gift shop. What's wrong with this mug? Spelled his actual name wrong. Yeah. Yeah. Stoughton has something that, here it is right here, number nine, etched in stone. In the 1, 2, 3, 4th line where it says for the future, you can barely see it. It still looks like an E slightly. Yeah. So if you go to Lincoln Memorial, make sure you check out the plaque that's there. See what's going on. And the funniest ones that I enjoy today. Anybody watch Jay Leno? He does headlines and stuff that are give you some of the things. You can live on this. Yep, absolutely. Crap yourself in a blanket. If you're cold. If you're sick, if you feel cold, put on a sweater, crap yourself in a blanket, turn up the heat. Recommended the physicians. Okay? Might not be exactly what we want to do. Here's your Missouri. They can't spell university. Number eight, it's a little hard to tell. I'll read it to you. It says, ladies, don't forget the rummage sale. It's a chance to get those of the things you no longer are worth keeping around the house. Don't forget your husbands. The peacemaking meeting scheduled for today has been canceled due to a conflict. Yes, some of those are proofreading errors, typos. Some of these are editing errors looking at your meaning. So let's talk about that. Oops, not there. There are costs. We started to put some dollars on some of this. Time and money, that's tangible. If you get involved in something, your company gets involved in a lawsuit, that's tangible. You are spending company resources, your time, the company's money to pay for the legal fees to do that. The website I have a link to, I won't actually go to, is turned out he didn't win it. It's kind of a nuisance lawsuit. The person that filed the lawsuit was upset because the telephone company published his phone number incorrectly. Let's see, how did it go? It was his phone number. But somehow it got attached to the cable company's name. So people thought they were calling the cable company and were actually calling him. He got so frustrated with it because he had contacted them and asked them to change it. And then after he had done this, he actually they actually sold the listing. The telephone company sold the listing to another place, and so the error was perpetuated. It grew. So he was so tired of being a nuisance to him, instead of changing his phone number, he filed a lawsuit against the company. He ended up losing it. They were saying that the telephone company was a protected company for the way they had their information. But think about it. It still took time. It still took your company resources. It still took legal fees to go through all of that. Mm-hmm. Profits. Rogers Communication in Canada. Excuse me. Because of where a comma was placed in a document, one of their partners was able to actually get out of a contract. This went through the courts. They were able to get out of a contract because of where a comma was placed. And Rogers Communications figures it cost them $1 million Canadian money. So that's like $888,888 in US dollars when you convert that back. Lockheed says they lost $70 million when somebody made a typo and moved a decimal in a number. Not fun. I can't even say this. Mizuho Securities, $225 million and counting. In this one, this is a company in Japan on the securities exchange, a trader mistaked transposed. Transpose is when you switch. So they transposed the quantity of shares to sell with the price it was to be sold at. Japan is even looking at regulations and all this kind of stuff because they ended up selling more shares than they actually had. So, you know, number one, you shouldn't be able to do that. But they were like pennies, half a penny, millisecond pennies on the dollar. And they figured it was, at the time that this article was written, it was $225 million. Do you think that trader has a job?
No.
Some of these you can recover from. You make a typo in an email, you know, saying hi to somebody, answering a question, you can recover from that. You make a typo of this magnitude, it costs a lot more. The 10 most costly, let's see what I've got under there. The question is, were they dyslexics? I honestly don't know. What didn't come up in the article was all from the company's perspective. But if you are, and we'll get into this, know your weaknesses and have methods in place to help you go through those. Super buy for $47, diamond accent cable necklace in sterling silver, $47 at Macy's. They had to honor this. It was supposed to be $497. Sold a lot of NASA. They consider the damage is like $80 million. They missed a hyphen. They were supposed to send, in 1962, the first interplanetary probe they were supposed to set up and get close to Venus, but they had a hyphen or dash wrong in the coding, and they went way off course. In fact, I think they exploded just minutes after takeoff. Ouch. Yeah. How long does it take you to build one of those? Long time. Now this antique ale, I've looked it up on Snopes. This might not be actually true, but the story is that somebody recognized an ale, an old beer that was for sale on eBay and bought it for like, oh, I don't know, it's 150 years old, and it was like, he purchases it for $304, and then he had a bid on it to sell it at $503,000. Now, Snopes says that the bid was false and they weren't actually going to go through with it, and I'm like, I think on eBay, if you make a bid, you have to go through with it, but we'll let them fight that out. They do consider that Wicked Bible I told you about is almost $4,600. They fined the London publisher £3,000 for it, for that error. Pasta gets racist. I can't even say that. Tagliatelle with sardines and prosciutto. A blunder in the Pasta Bible recommended seasoning it with salt and freshly ground black people. Again, that's probably the same error I showed you in a minute ago. Here's the Mizuho Securities, car dealership. See a lot of these. Exotic vacation becomes X-rated, cost $10 million. They had a typo and they got more in different clientele than they were hoping for. You think? So those are things you can put dollar amounts on. Those are costly. Lives. Walgreens lost a case. This one's sad. A teenage pharmacy assistant, RH, actually made a typing error in a prescription they were typing in and gave a wrong dosage and ended up, I've got two stories. One's like a six-year-old girl, one's an adult woman, but they both died. This other one, Cullen Care, same thing. Error in a prescription, somebody took it. I think that's, anyways, the woman actually died before her case could go to trial. The The six-year-old girl, her parents were fighting the case for it. You can't put a cost on a life, can you? I know we try. Insurance tries, government tries with 911, 9/11, all this stuff. But can you really put a cost on life? Not. Jobs, can you put a cost on a job that you could lose? You can put a cost on your salary. You got to exponentially pull it out bigger. I mean, then you've got a harder job. Getting through it for the next round of interviews. Why did you lose that job? What are you doing now? There's a lot that goes into it. Things that are priceless, like we talked about, your first impression. We said it takes repetitive encounters, quality repetitive encounters. You can't put a price on that. Your company reputation. I've given you some company names, some company names I've not given you. Which ones are you going to remember? The company names I gave you. They're now notorious in your mind. You walk in, you're thinking, oh, do I want to do business with the company? What are they doing? You're going to question more what happens. Get a little notoriety that you didn't want. You want to be causing positive images for yourself and your companies. In those companies, did I give you any names of any employees that actually made the error? But who knows? The individual knows. Your coworkers know. So if you find yourself on a job where people are kind of avoiding you and they never give you stuff to write, you might want to look at your proofreading and editing skills. Or again, as we said earlier, if you have this weakness, if this is not one of your strengths, buddy up. Network with people that do. I have people I email. There are some people, my degree is not in English. I have a knack for it, and I have worked it on my jobs. I have learned it. But I have English writers in my network that if I don't know how to figure something out, I'm emailing them going, hey, I have this sentence. I know it's wrong, but I cannot label what's wrong with it for a student. Can you tell me? And I put those resources in place. Stress. You can't put a price on stress. What do you know about stress? Where does stress manifest itself in your life? Test anxiety? We're getting ready for those. Where else? Too much thinking? What was that?
Anxiety in general?
Sure. Life can be anxious sometimes. We are doing things at such fast speed that can you keep up? Can you do anything? It's just, wow. I'm ready to unplug and go home. Stress manifests itself in your health. Anybody like me get a kink in the neck? I feel it right there in my neck. Oh, great. I'm stressed about something. Your back. Could be headaches, migraines. That's one thing that causes migraines. What about emotional? Your physical well-being. What about being the person that actually put those prescriptions in wrong? And now going through the rest of your life, figuring out how to handle that situation and do it well and overcome it. And you can. It just takes some time. Think about, where's another one, malpractice. Pops up. Where'd you go to get your hand done?
Hospital.
Health professions. Doctors, nurses, patient care. Full of malpractice lawsuits. They are human. They do very excellent work, but they are human, and every once in a while something happens. Can you imagine the stress? Learning to deal with that? All right, let's again try to work to minimize our personal proofreading and editing errors. I'm going to give you a sentence. Let's stand up. Yep, stretch it out there. I'm going to give you a sentence, and when this sentence appears on the screen, I want you to count the letter F. All you have to do is go through the sentence and count the letter F. But you can only count once. Okay? Guys, stand up if you would, please. When you are done counting, please sit down, and we'll find out who has what. So, you ready? Got your thinking cap on? There's no grade to this. Just count them once. Let's see what pops up here. All right. How many found seven? Anybody for seven? You found seven F's? You are really good. You can have a whole handful.
This was on brain games.
Seven F's. I'm really proud of her. Who found six? Share and share alike. Pass it down. Mm-hmm. Who else found six over here? Who found five? Yep, that's it. Yep, we got it. All right. Fives, here comes a toss. Oops, sorry, I forgot to tell you, I bad aim. But some people can catch a bad aim. Let's see what's really here. I want to know, where are the seven F's? Tell us where the seven F's are. You said you found seven. You got to prove it. To keep your candy, you got to prove it. Where'd you find them? Tell your neighbor, whisper to your neighbor, and she can tell us. One in finished,
one in
files,
of,
scientific, of, that's what I want to know. How'd you get seven? There's only six. Good thing I gave out the candy first, huh? Average intelligence finds three of them. If you spotted four, you're above average. Congratulations. If you've got five, you can turn up your nose at most anybody. And if you found all six, you are a genius. There's no catch. All right, or an English teacher. You can be a genius too. Yeah. Your brain reads them. These words, the word of, your brain reads that as OV. Oh, let's try this one, I'll show you. Read this one. Wouldn't surprise me a bit. I've used it for years, like since 2003. Bottom line, you actually could read it, couldn't you?
Yeah.
Now, if you check it out on Snopes, they're going to tell you that it's that Cambridge says they never did a research on it, but everybody's still putting it around like it was Cambridge's work. So, good stuff. But that is the problem with proofreading. We read, and our mind thinks for us. Just like that. So we're going to need some strategies to help our mind stop and think instead of reading ahead and assuming what's going to be there. Our mind assumes. Difference between editing and proofreading. Proofreading is simple comparison. It's mechanical. Did what I start with match what I ended up with? Are they exactly the same? Editing is more analytical. Judgmental. Editing is the process that says, okay, I have this stuff here, but should it be here? Is this good information? Is it going to be effective? Is the reader going to understand what we're saying? Are these good word choices? So editing is where you ask the questions. Proofreading is where you simply compare what I started with to what I had. You want to understand the difference. When you're proofreading, you're actually looking at repeated words. Ever seen a sentence, something like, today is Thursday? There's the teacher. Says, yes, I've seen it. I found it in my son's emails that I thought were perfect when I sent them out. So I've got that going on. How about substitutions and omissions? We've been fiends for years. What do you think they were for years, really? Friends.
Perhaps fiends,
but there are a few of those. Hatfields and McCoys come to mind on it. Key data errors. So you're looking to see if there were any data typed incorrectly. Dates. Make sure that the date that's listed in the original is the date that you have in your copy. Phone numbers, same thing. Names, I gave a sample here of Catherine. There's more than one way to spell Catherine. There's a lot of ways to spell Catherine. The original had T-H-A-R, and the completed copy ended up with T-H-E-R. Addresses, same thing. Transpositions, as I said, that's where you switch things. I have a friend that knows very well the phrase tot he. What's that supposed to be?
To the.
Word, actually, it went into their autocorrect, so we don't have to worry about it as much anymore. Now, if you really want tot he, you have to go back and fix it to make it tot he, because it autocorrects it. But yes, that's a transposition of the space and the T. Same thing with numbers. Anybody know the trick that if you can add up your column of numbers and it comes up to a 9, it's most likely a transposition in one of your numbers? 297 versus 279. It's going to be divisible by 9. And words, you can actually, those spacing, punctuation, and format. So those are the things that you're comparing when you're looking at proofreading. And I do have a handout for you at the end that has some of this stuff on it. So notes are good, but I'll also share this with those of you that want it. Editing. When you're in editing, you're looking at spelling, going, did you spell it right? What's the difference between T-O, T-W-O, and T-O-O? Is there a difference? Yeah. Lot of difference, right? Big difference. I'm going to something, I've had too much to eat, or I need two friends. Or I have two friends. Let's not need them, let's have them. Notice that the asterisk, spelling, punctuation, grammar usage, and yes, those four are the most common errors that you find. And that's what we were looking at earlier in all those types of errors that we had pulled up from the internet. Punctuation. How would you punctuate the sentence? Woman without her man is nothing. This is a common one. It's always fun to do. Who wants to try it? We have a suggestion that after woman, we put a comma. Woman, comma, without her man is nothing. Woman without her man is I don't like without her man. I don't like a comma there because it breaks up the whole sentence. Guess what? I didn't bring my solution. What would you?
After woman and her.
Okay, that's what I'm thinking of. Thank you. We said put one after woman, without her man is nothing. But you need the second comma after her. Woman, without her, man is nothing. See the different emphasis depending on where you put the comma? All right, punctuation. Those are things that in editing you question. Is this really what we mean to say? Grammar and uses, inconsistent. Now, fact checking. When I said in proofreading, that you actually look at dates and you compare them to the original, that is correct. That's what you do. In editing, you go back to the calendar. I learned early on that I actually had an issue with dates. For example, today is Thursday, October 23. Is that true?
No.
It worked for me for a day. So I learned I needed to check my days of the week against the date that I was listing. And then I got a letter. My office got a letter from somebody that we were going to recreate, and use the same exact same information. I proofed it extremely carefully 2 or 3 times because this was a very important letter going to some high profile people in the city. A few days later, I get called into my boss's office. There's a typo in your dates. No, there's not. I triple proof that. And they said, yes, this Tuesday is not this date. I said, then there's an error in the original letter. And I went back and pulled it out, and sure enough, there's an error in the original letter. So it's not enough, especially like dates, and I've got up here numbers, various things. It's not enough to proof it against the original. The editing process takes it to confirm that the original was correct on it. Yep, excellent. Emails and websites are being added. Phone numbers. I had a boss get upset with me once because a flyer we sent out that someone else put together had a typo in it for the phone number to the RSVP for an event. And they're like, I would have thought you would catch that. And I'm like, I don't know that phone number. And it dawned on me, I should have called the phone number. I would have gotten the error message and said, this phone number is not right. What is the actual correct phone number? You're absolutely right. Emails and websites, if you're putting those out there, click the link and make sure it works before you actually put it into a flyer or some type of correspondence for someone else to send out to them. Absolutely, I'm gonna write that down before I forget it. If I forget it, bring it back up to me. So the editing process is where you're really questioning what's happening. And read it through for effectiveness. For example, I was sending letters to parents of middle school and high school students, of which I do not have any. I would take my letter over to one of my coworkers that did have students in that grade, those grade ranges, and say, how would you feel if you received this? What does this say to you? And I would get that reader's perspective. So you can always talk to people. If you're sending something to an instructor, you can talk to a different instructor and say, you know, how would instructors perceive this? If you're sending something to a classmate, you can talk to another classmate. How would you feel about if you read this, if you received this, would you be upset? All right? So strategies. Number one, you're doing good things right now, you're preparing. Learn your grammar rules. Whatever it takes for your learning strategy, figure it out and learn your grammar and spelling rules. Then make sure that you also improve your reading skill. Keep reading and read to improve the level of your reading so that you understand a variety of complex words. Not just a lot of the stuff we study right at the 8th grade level. Well, boost your reading up until 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th, 13th level so that you can have a better, larger vocabulary to work with. One of the things that they would tell people at banks, one of the ways that they would tell counterfeit money was by constantly handling the real thing. So as you improve your reading and writing skills, then you will more easily recognize what's happening in a document when you see it. Purchase the recommended reference manual for your industry. I don't know what you're going into. In the office administration world, Greg reference manual is our Bible. That's what our class uses that I talked about. We created our proofread and editing class, and we go through and practice how to use that to find questions in it. It's not enough just to know your rules, but if somebody questions you, you want to have a resource to go to and say, this is what I follow. And the person who questions you will either go, oh, okay, thanks, or they'll say, that's not how we do it at this company, and you will make a note of that and adjust for the next time you write that kind of document. Coworkers may not have the same level of skill that you do and be relying on you, come to you and ask you a question about it. You want to be able to point them to a resource. So get the resource manual that works for your profession, the industry you're headed into, and learn to use it well. So your actual process, a lot of websites I've got under sources have different types of process. The OWL at Purdue, North Carolina, University of North Carolina has a different one, Colorado State. They all have some little tweaking of information. But here's your basic idea. If you're writing it, walk away. Give yourself time to let it breathe, let it set, because what happens? The more you read it at a time and setting there, the more your brain gets used to what's supposed to be there and you skip things, like that phrase, to be or not to be. People had seen it so often, their brain skipped it through three proofreaders right there. We read it through for comprehension. Does it make sense? Is it all here? And we already said at the beginning of the class, we can read it backwards to compare to the original. And another thing we talked about having someone else read your work is you can do a reading back and forth. Statistical data, for example, I used to work at a company that held a research day where medical people in the medical professions were presenting their research. A lot of words I didn't know, a lot of names I didn't know. And when they put the program together, two of us would sit and literally read and spell back and forth to each other to make sure what was on the original submission from the medical professional was what we had it ended up in the program. Now, I don't know how they proofed the who cares, why bother flyer, but it can be that kind of thing. When it's that important, you want to take the extra step to make sure it's right. Statistical data, names, all those kind of things would be perfect for it. Even if you're learning proofreading, it's perfect for it. And when you're doing that, reading out loud, you actually speak the punctuation. Start at the bottom, period, last word, next word, comma, next word, capitalized, period. You read it backwards to get your mind to stop and think. Your turn. Here's today's description of the seminar we've got this morning, the presentation. Edit it. Raise your hand when you've got something you think should be changed. Raise your hand. Back row, what did I see? The you after can you? All right, so you're starting on this line. She's starting down here under can you. That's texting. This would be under text language. This would be under effectiveness. You're not going to have an effective communication if you put texting language into a letter to a client, especially if that client doesn't text. You know, my mom just came into cell phones a couple years ago. There's no way she's getting into texting. On a drive last weekend, she tried. My brother was driving, so he's like, I can't text and drive. Can you text Bethann? And she got the A. She's like, how do I get to the C? And we're like, well, there's another one. All right. So you got to think about your audience. What did you, sir, do you have one? You are should be your up here in the title, right? Yep. Raise your hands. Let's see who's got another one. What's it? Off. Where's it go? Where'd it go? We've explored types off errors. We want of errors. These are errors in spelling or word usage. Could be either category they go under. Sir, what'd you have? Two. Spending time to proofread. We already talked about that. Should be T-O. Right behind it in the gray.
The your in the first
Y-O-U-R, yep. Oh, sorry. You're waiting for us to get to that one?
Yes.
This one bothered her so much she couldn't leave it. Didn't see any of the rest of them. That is Y-O-U-R. Excellent. Did you have one? Who else? Anything else? What's this word? What's this word down here? Affect versus effect. I can affect something, but it is effective when I do it, when I do that strategy.
Companies.
What's wrong with companies? It's possessive, not plural. And do you know when I made up my key, when I made my original, the head was spelled correctly, I actually did that wrong. I caught it yesterday, and I'm like, what? Can't put this out in a presentation. We all do it. Good. I think that's what's happening there. Now, this one's just your practice in proofreading. You may do this with a partner and read out loud if you want to, or you can do it by yourself. This one, let's stand up, and when you have it done, you can sit back down. Stand on up. All right. Stand up if you found something in the first row. Who found an error in the first row? First line. Stand up on that one. What did he have? First line of the copy. Indentation. That's a format error. Inconsistency of format. Oh, she got yours already? Anyone else find anything in the first row? Stand up in the first row. Now remember, in the proofreading, we are simply comparing the original and the copy. We're not making judgments yet about it. We're simply comparing. Nothing else in the first row? Uh-oh, what do you see? There's actually an extra space between these two words. Now, this one takes a little bit more time and effort to get to. If I was proofreading this on my screen, I would have increased my zoom a little bit. Or I have a tip where I literally go and do a find for two spaces and replace it with one space, just to eliminate this kind of possibility when I'm all done with my document. Second line, do we have any? Anything in the second line? Stand on up. What do you think's in the second line?
In the copy says receive it necessary, and the other one says receive it necessary.
We have an extra word. So that went under omission substitutions. Okay. We have candy. We have more candy. We have candy. Do we have anything else in the second row? What do you say?
Save your document again. It's supposed to be save your document again.
In the second line?
Oh,
it's on the third line.
All right, we moved on to the third line. All right, move to the third line. Resave, collect your. Gosh, I can't even find it now. Who else had them? Anything else in the third line? I have candy. Fourth line. Third line. Third line, what do you have?
What are you doing first?
Your should be, yes. You are having your with the partial R, you give it to her.
Okay, so save. Yes. Here's what you're both saying. One of you found this word, save your document, should be you should be your. The other one found the other your. This should be a contraction, you are. Excellent. Anything in the last line? Yep, we have an error of omissions. Anything else in that last line? One more. Your guys are dying for candy. I hear you are. I never got you. You had the first one, didn't you? Was that the last one? You can still have one. Mm-hmm. What else?
I can't see it.
I have one more. You can walk up front. I know. How dare we walk in the middle of a presentation? One more. What do you have? Nope, try it. Okay. What do you say?
There's a comma after the document. And it shouldn't be.
There's a comma after the word document, and there should be, but what's the actual problem with it? It's the space between the comma and the word document. So this is proofreading, simply comparing your copy to your original. The other one was where we ask questions and says, is this appropriate? Got it? All right. So did we meet our goals? What are some types of errors in writing?
Dates.
Holler them out.
Dates,
grammatical,
format.
Good. What are some ways to ensure your writing is free and effective, error-free and effective?
Proofread.
What's our strategy for proofreading? Compare, read it backwards, those kind of things. So have you chuckled today? Have you groaned? No, we haven't grown. Have we actually laughed? Can you put a price on your reputation? No, they are priceless. Here's my contact information, and I've got it on a handout for you, and additional resources. These are also beyond here. So I will leave you with this fun little bugger right here. One more opportunity to laugh as you go, and I will be here for questions if you have any.